Hey! Sorry to startle you. I'm Andy Kindler. Welcome to ShowbizMonkeys.com. Around this town, I'm all right. Around this town,
I'm all right. I mean, no consequence when you playing with the fire. Move to the left, man. No, you've done a million of these, right?
Oh, I'm a pro. I'm a pro in terms of, I'm technically a pro in terms of how many years I've been doing it. That's not saying I'm doing it well.
I'm just thinking it'd be really funny to me anyway, if someone, they weren't a comedian or a celebrity, they were just a pro at doing interviews, just being interviewed, that's it, that's their skill.
You mean like Donald Trump?
Well, I mean, the pro is a bit of a stretch with him too.
Yeah. He's the world's leading best fascist at giving interviews.
He seems over the last year to be the most interviewed person.
Right, always on his own terms. He's at home.
Yeah, exactly. And, on the phone
and at home, and just there's no risk.
I do find it quite interesting that after literally decades of history with Meet the Press and things like that, they've just thrown all their rules out the window for Trump.
Well, it's even, it's like if you're watching today, it's like you have this guy, Chris Matthews, who's built his whole career on just, he started as a Clinton basher. Now he bashes Obama, he bashes, it's whose fault is the attack, and why is Obama playing a baseball game in Cuba, and he's like bringing on Representative Peter King and all the usual anti-Muslim suspects. I mean, it really is, maybe there was never a good journalism. But it does seem worse.
I mean, I hope there was, and I hope there are some people out there still trying to do some good work.
Oh, I mean, there's always people. I mean, even when the Second Gulf War happened, you had the McClatchy group of newspapers, and they were onto it from the beginning. But, like, otherwise, anybody I knew who had a brain knew as soon as Cheney and Bush wanted to go into the Iraq that it was all based on. It was all a lie. Everybody knew it except the media, or they didn't want to know it, because a lot of times they just want to go with. It really is as like nakedly horrible as show business. They want to go with ratings, and it is show business, unfortunately. But there are great people doing. There are great journalists, but
they're harder to find.
Exactly. Well, you can find them on Twitter. But I can find good things on Twitter after I spend 18 hours arguing with robots.
Personally, I enjoy following you on Twitter.
Thank you.
I wrote down in my notes here that I often find the things you say as kind of my barometer for common sense. You usually have a pretty good common sense look at what's going on with the craziness of the world and politics and beyond. You must, I hope, for the amount of time you spend on there, enjoy the aspect of Twitter and getting to, speak your mind and things like that.
Well, I appreciate what you're saying. It makes me feel good. And I like a lot of times I think it is. I mean, I can get angry and enraged and all this kind of stuff. But to me, it's like common sense. I mean, to me, it's like I was raised to just in general, not hate people based on their religious affiliation. So when you're on this thing and you're arguing with these like people, and they're saying, because one of the things a lot of these bigots do is they use like things like, oh, we're not allowed to criticize a religion now. that's the guys under which they say the most horrible things about Muslims. Oh, we can't, it's wrong. You say one bad thing and now you're a bigot? No, you're a bigot. You just happen to be a bigot because of what you've been saying. It's not because it's illegal to make comments that are critical. But I do get addicted. I do get addicted to Twitter. Is a problem. I have to work on it. And I mean, I wish I was in a 12-step program.
It was originally supposed to just be a promotional tool, right? That's what comics were supposed to use Twitter for, just for promotion. And then it becomes almost life-consuming at times.
Well, for the very first time I used it, and even going in, most comics told me who were on there already, they were saying that if you just promote things, your account gets very boring. It starts to look like that's all you're doing. So from the beginning, I think people thought it'd be a funny way to either, you know, some comics back then or maybe still now look at it as a way to experiment with jokes. And to me, it's more like I like to use it to say whatever comes to my mind, and then sometimes it'll end up as jokes.
Mm-hmm.
One did end up as a joke that my nephew told me, oh, you should use that joke in your act, as he likes to call it. And that was a tweet where I said, I believe it was the great philosopher Descartes who said, I think, therefore am I right, ladies?
Yes, the last time you were in Winnipeg, I believe you used that.
Right, and now sometimes, though, things that I tweet that I think are funny, just as words, they don't work as stand-up.
Right. Well, I mean, certainly in general, the spoken word versus written word, there's nuances there that make things different, so that makes sense.
Yeah, and many times my act is good on paper.
A little over a year ago in Los Angeles, I went to the particular show that you do monthly at Nerd Melt there.
I love the way you say that. It makes it sound like it's an institution.
It's been
over a year, but it's I guess a year and a half, yeah. So it sounds cool when you say it.
Yeah, I guess I caught it kind of early on, I guess, then. And now it's become an institution over the last year and a bit. But I was wondering, for those who you know, may not be in LA or visit LA and haven't had a chance to see it, can you talk a little bit about that show? I found when I saw it, it was loose, but not in a lazy way. Like it seemed like every comic that was on the bill was just having a really good time.
Well, I think anybody who sees me do stand up, I mean, you might not say I'm doing it the lazy way, but you also wouldn't say, well, he's really working hard on his material. Yeah, the basic premise of the show is that in the late 90s, or maybe the mid 90s, I don't know, I can't keep track of any sense of time, but I did an alternative show at the Just for Last Festival. You know, it was back when, quote, alternative comedy was in its, starting to make some noise. I don't know what I'm saying.
Right.
And then, so I would host this show, so I hosted the show, and it was really fun, and I really like hosting. And so the idea is that I'm picking the comics, so that's why it's called The Particular Show, and then I open up doing material, and then I do material in between the acts. Now, I know people listening to this or reading this or divining this telepathically will say that I'm not reinventing the wheel. I'm quite aware that I'm not reinventing the wheel, but I'm making it more attractive. That's one of my jokes, actually.
A very pretty wheel.
Yeah, I have a joke. They say you can't reinvent the wheel, but does it have to be so round? No one laughs. Don't worry about that one. So, yeah, and the other thing is it does fit my general style of commenting on everything. It's kind of easier to comment on everything when you're hosting a show because I always like when I come up in between the acts, because you always get, there's some always awkward sense of why are you returning?
Yeah.
But the other part of the show is that I really do want to showcase people I think are hilarious. And right now it's a good time period for that because I think comedy, there's so many amazingly great comics and different types of amazingly great comics.
Well, yeah, like there's so much out there, and it's certainly a lot easier to find comedy than it was 10, 15, 20 years ago. But the worry then is that, you know, some really good comics might end up not finding an audience because there's so much out there.
Well, the idea, I hate to use the word monetize, but let me start using it liberally. It's hard to monetize anything in life right now.
Yeah.
But it is definitely better. Everything about comedy is better than it was when I was I was really lucky because I came up during the comedy boom of the 80s and 90s. So I got tons of work, but the crowds are you know, just on the most rudimentary level that in the 90s, you couldn't, if you didn't know who the comic was, you couldn't see any footage of the comic really, you know, you couldn't like look at a clip online. And now mm-hmm. people go to clubs, if they have any kind of incentive at all or do any work on their own part, they'll know who they're coming to see. I think it's kind of a it's a kind of a really great environment right now. But as I'm saying it, I feel like I'm probably jinxing it.
This interview alone is going to completely tank the comedy industry.
Plus, I don't want to sound too positive in general because my image is the angry curmudgeon. I'm the angry curmudgeon. Get off of my comedy lawn.
Well, that can lead nicely into my next question, which is...
kidding me? I've never had a good segue in my entire life.
your state of the industry address at Just for Laughs.
Yes, sir. I don't know why I felt the need to answer that. Yes, sir.
you can get a little curmudgeonly there at times, but in a very entertaining way that people look forward to every year. How did that whole thing start? Like how did Just for Laughs approach you about even doing that to begin with? And it must be a fun thing to prepare for every year.
Well, you ask that question like someone who's not frightened, but you don't want to set off an old cranky guy. Because you said something like, you're a little bit, you say things there. Like, I'm like, everything I say is the truth and nice. Well, I don't know. It started, I'll give you a short version, which will be about 25 minutes.
I'll start the time with that.
Start the time. I had written an article for the National Lampoon on called the Hack Comics Handbook. It's still on my website, everybody. Run there right now. None of the above. And it was about, why it was during the boom, and the boom was about to implode, and about what was bad about, pointing out, the structure was, here, I'm going to show you how to be a terrible comedian. And I used all the things that were going around at the time. And I actually gave a demonstration of 1 year, like with Patton Oswalt and Blaine Kapach and a bunch of people. I demonstrated hack comedy. It's in a way, it's not as applicable now because there's not as much hack comedy. There's a lot of hack stuff on Twitter, like when people say on Twitter, like when they go, because science, or... they say, said no one ever. Uh-huh. So there's a lot of hacky things on Twitter. But then there were a lot of really hacky things in comedy. So I did a demonstration, and then the festival asked me, hey, why don't you just come up and give another speech? So my manager, Bruce Smith, suggested I call a state of the industry, and like I would be the person who looks back at the comedy year and says what happened. Of course, the first time we did it, we didn't think it would happen. I thought it would be a one-time thing. Mm-hmm. And it's just now it's going to be the 20 years. I'm giving the 20th speech this year. It's a long time.
Yeah, that is. Now that's an institution.
Yeah, I mean, I had a lot of Ray, what if Reagan were a network television executive jokes. I had a lot of Nixon in Full House material. but it has become kind of I do have a love-hate relationship with it because I never know how it's going to go, and I almost faint before I give it, although I'm getting better at panicking over the years. But it's all new material every year, too, except I take the material I've written over the year that are actual jokes that are about comedy or show business or whatever, and then I add other stuff that are usually some kind of rant, not like Dennis Miller. I don't want to ever be associated with Dennis Miller. And of course, there's a hit or miss aspect to it. It's like it's like walking on a tightrope on the ground.
Right. Well, I mean, it is the kind of thing, unlike normal stand up, where a lot of the stuff you don't have an opportunity to test it out in open mics in other rooms because it's specifically meant for that audience.
Well, also, over the years, I changed my methodology. Early on, the first few years of the speech, it was when people were going to the festival and getting sitcom deals. Like, that seemed to be not the purpose to be a stand-up comic, but that's what a lot of people got into stand-up comedy for. Mm-hmm. Not everybody, obviously. But so I was talking about that specific thing that was happening then, and that made, I don't know, I kind of lost my train of thought. What was the question?
I was talking about not being able to work out the material.
Oh, okay. Now I remember. I have ADD. I changed my methodology. So early on, I would do things like I read from the trades for a couple of years, and then I would like read about. I would always have a section of these are the sitcoms coming out. But I've learned over the years now, people the reason why people came there originally to see the speech, it doesn't even exist anymore, which is like the networks are rolling out their new sitcoms and everyone's focused on it. No one's focused on the quote like industry the way I was originally doing it. So the experimentation comes from either me yelling about something that bothers me, or you know, it is going to be the first time probably 20 to 30 minutes of it has ever been said. So there's a lot of filler.
It doesn't necessarily mean it's
angry
filler.
Filler.
It just means
angry
it's untested.
Filler.
Okay, filler.
Untested rage.
Now you have obviously that long-standing relationship with Just for Laughs, and you've done the Toronto one as well. And I don't know if you were just in the first Vancouver one recently, because I'm apparently bad at research.
I think I did something in Vancouver, but I feel like Bob Dylan. I was in Vancouver and something, I don't know. That was a bad Bob Dylan, and it made no sense. But I was in Vancouver, but I'm not sure. I feel like I'm being. If this is not a court of law. But I cannot confirm or deny anything you're saying.
There will be no strict fact checking on these statements. So no concerns.
Yeah. Okay.
No, but yeah, this will be your first time coming to the Winnipeg Comedy Fest, which is a more independent, smaller festival. So I'm just curious about what you're expecting with the Winnipeg Comedy Fest. What you've heard about it from other comics that you know that have been here, and yeah, what you're thinking of Winnipeg in a few weeks.
Well, I have heard about it before, and I'm always angling for a festival I haven't done. So, yes, I was like, "Oh, who books that? What's the deal? How come they haven't called me? What are they personally against me?" But I love Winnipeg because in a romantic, no actual knowledge of the city way, because of I imagine Neil Young still hanging around, and I went there in 1988. I used to work for Yuck Yucks West.
Okay, yeah,
that sounds impressive, and that's where I met Brent Butt, who's like the greatest and a Canadian legend. Brent Butt, I met him there, and I was in Osborne Village, like in the late 80s. I just loved the city. Of course, it was the summertime, and there was like boating events, and it seemed like idyllic. And then I came, and I think there was a club called Rumors.
Yeah, that's still around. Rumors.
And I didn't do well there.
No? Okay.
I was there for 2 weeks. Did not do well. Bombed. Bombed a lot. Bombed often. And then I was back. I did a little theater there last year. So I've been up there, and I had a great time. And not a theater, maybe it's a bar. I did. It was really wonderful.
Yeah, it's a theater, the Park Theater, yeah.
Yes, I love. Yes, I don't know why I got hyper excited. Yeah, that was really great. So I'm always excited to come there, but I'm also doing a TV thing, and it's like they're filming it. I think it's for some, I don't want to get too technical, but it's for some Canadian TV thing.
It's for the Winnipeg Comedy Fest galas are all aired on CBC, our national broadcaster.
Right, and I think I'm supposed to have a theme. It's, you know, it's like I'm playing catch up, and then I'm doing a version of the debaters there, which I've done before, which I love. And then I guess I'll be just sitting around with autograph hounds coming up to me.
Yeah, of
and,
course.
I don't know if you have paparazzi in Winnipeg, but maybe they'll be bugging me.
I can bring my camera around if that makes you feel more comfortable.
And it should be seasonably warm, right?
Well, by April, it should be. You're a New Yorker, so it wouldn't be much different than New York at that time of year.
Yeah. Oh, but the last time I was up there, I talked to people about the dead of winter.
Oh yeah.
And they seemed
in
dead.
January.
You could see them. Yeah, they could see them as if they could remember that feeling of death. In the winter.
You don't want to come here in January. And it's always funny, just going back to Just for Laughs, they do a national tour every year across the country. They bring comics across to, you know, a dozen cities across the country. And they always do it right in the middle of the winter. And I feel terrible for especially American comics that are coming up and doing that because they don't know.
Yeah, there's no reason to subject an American comic who's not someone who lives in Vermont or Alaska. There's no reason to subject them because we're a very weak species. You know what I'm saying? We're not survivalists. You won't see any of us like Leonardo DiCaprio, whatever he did in that last movie, where he was, I don't know what it was. He was in a, was it one continuous shot of him in the woods?
Basically, but it was, yeah, that was in Canada. He filmed that in Canada.
He did?
Yeah. Yeah, that was filmed in Alberta.
Of all the Revenant movies, that's my favorite. So yeah, no, but then the other thing is, I also had great coffee when I was up. I'm a coffee snob, elitist. I'm a light roast coffee maven and an absolutist. A light roast coffee absolutist, and I had some great coffee up there. So I think it's a happening city.
You'll be delighted. There's already a couple new coffee shops that have opened up since the last time you were here.
I just literally said, "What's that?" I don't know. So take that out. Take everything out. Take everything out where you can hear my breathing. Uh-huh. Take everything out where you can hear my thumb furring.
Yep.
And in fact, if you could have somebody else like do my voice, it'd be better for me. Like maybe a British person.
I know a couple. I know a couple.
Or a Canadian who says process. I know you say process, right?
How would you say it? I'm confused now.
Process.
Oh, I guess it would. I think with a lot of those words, I find, and maybe it's just because I've grown up with, you know, Canadian and American television inundating me.
Yes.
But I find it changes depending on what I'm referring to. You know, the way I might pronounce the word.
Oh yeah, it's like in Canada, you know what's going on, so it's your choice about how to, you know. But it's like when you get to expiry date, I mean, at that point, let's just cut it out. That's what I tell Canadians when they say expiry date. I laugh, not in their face, because they, you know, Canadians, they always say Canadians are polite, but there's another part of Canadians who, aren't there Canadians who will punch you in the face so hard that it will go through to your back of your head? There's tough people up there, right? Am I wrong?
There's a reason there's fighting in hockey. I mean, there's...
Yes, exactly.
There's an underlying rage.
Have you heard that Warren Zevon's song, I think it's called Hit Somebody? It's about... It has David Letterman say, "Hit Somebody." It's a really amazing song about a guy who's a Canadian who wants to score goals, but he has the only thing he's good at. This guy, I'm not saying all Canadians, but yeah. This guy, he's from Saskatoon, and the only thing he's good at is being a goon. You know, like knocking people out. I'm very sorry for this last.
No,
part.
No. I was gonna say, have you seen the movie from a couple years ago called Goon?
Wait a second. Are you telling? Is this the thing that people say like a Kevin Smith movie?
No. No,
Kevin Smith is making a movie about that song.
He might be making a movie more directly related to the song. This movie just happened to have the title Goon, and it's about a goon, but I don't think it relates to the Warren Zevon song.
Was it good, though? Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, it's Jay Baruchel co-wrote it and stars in it.
I love Jay Baruchel. First of all, I love Jay Baruchel, and I'm hoping that this interview that I'm doing, you know, gets me higher in the Jay Baruchel radar. Yeah, that sounds great. I love it. Yeah, I will check it out now.
I'll make sure it gets to him.
Are you going to give me a viewer's copy? I don't know what I was doing there. What is your movie award show? Gemini's?
They combined them a couple years ago, and now it's just the Canadian Screen Awards handles TV and movies.
I like that. Screen Awards.
Yeah.
I like the idea that you're focusing just on the screen. Like, I have a mini iPad that would be great for that. All right, look, obviously I've run out of comedy, and I promise people of Winnipeg, I will not do this kind of material, my Screen Awards bit up there. But I will bring my patented giggle.
Good, good. And I'll be in the audience doing my own patented giggle as well, which is different. There can be more than one giggle patented.
Now, I really don't want to mislead people into thinking that you can patent a giggle. Again, no charge for this kind of comedy, no charge for wordplay.
I mean, you can patent a lot of weird stuff now. They seem to let you.
Yeah, but is a patent as good as a trademark, or is a trademark worse than a patent, or is it both of them? Trademark sounds like more like you can make more money from it. Like if I trademark, hey, what's the name of the Winnipeg team?
Jets.
Hey, Jets, are you going to win a Stanley Cup or what? See if I trademark that. Make t-shirts. You can't make them. When was the last time they won, the Jets?
No, they haven't.
The Winnipeg Jets have not won?
No.
All right, so here's my new material. Ladies and gentlemen, I like your hockey team here in Winnipeg. You know, I heard that Benny and the Jets won more Stanley Cups. Anybody?
I'll give you a quick bit of random old Winnipeg trivia. The first version of the Winnipeg Jets, because they went away to Phoenix, the first version of the Winnipeg Jets, their mascot was Benny.
Oh, from the song?
Yeah, because that's, yeah.
That doesn't sound good. First of all, I'm not going to be scared of that team.
No. The mascot didn't look like any. It was just like one of those random mascots that are just nothing. They're not a human. They're not a... Like, it wasn't a jet, even though it was called Benny. Anyway.
It was amazing is my limited knowledge of everything, because I just figured, oh, any major city, every major city in Canada must have their own hockey team, but it would be impossible, right?
Well, I mean, they would all like to.
Right, but there's not a, what's the capital of Ontario?
Well, Toronto's the capital of Ontario, and then Ottawa's the capital of
Ontario. Oh, yeah, there's no Ottawa City NHL team, is there?
Yeah, there is.
Maybe there is.
The Ottawa Senators.
Oh my God! I'm never gonna talk about hockey again. It's worse than I thought, folks. I have a special type it's a medical thing that I'm suffering from sports dementia. I can remember everything else, every other name, but it's not. So please don't take it as an insult to hockey.
I'm more of a football guy anyway, so I personally don't. I'm not concerned.
Once I flew into Toronto, I think it was, and by the time I got from the airport to the hotel, the Toronto hockey team had lost a 2-goal lead in the playoffs, and they lost that game just from the ride.
They're a notoriously bad team.
But I'm a New York Jets fan, and I'm a New York Mets fan, so... Nobody can outdo me in terms of tragedy.
At least the Mets won in the 80s.
No, actually, I am so old that I remember the 1969 Mets and the 1968 Jets who won the Super Bowl in 69. I remember praying to young Andy Kindler, praying to a young God, said, God, I'll never ask you for anything else. This is it. I'm good for life. And I lie about it. I lie about it, but I still, I get upset when they lose.
Of course. And it's your hometown team, so of course you'll stick with them even through losing.
I will stick with them through thin and even thinner.
One other show that you're doing in Winnipeg that I'm personally excited about is you're on the Tales from Late Night show, which is, you know, a bunch of comics that have done late night television over the years. And I'm an unabashed late night diehard. I don't know how else to word that, but I watch and have for many years watched a lot of late night television. So, of course, I've seen your many, many appearances on Letterman and other places before.
Cool.
How's it been for you as someone who used to make regular appearances on Letterman? How's it been to not have him on the air anymore?
Well, it's a personal tragedy for me in America, but I do think he gets to spend more time with his son Harry, so he's probably I think ultimately going to be happy about it. But I don't know. Why do I sound like a late show ambassador? But I do. I still have the 20 episodes I've never watched because it was too. You know, I was just. The whole thing was overwhelming. So I still have those from the last year that I need to watch. And he was the man from my generation. Not my generation. I mean, it was Carson. Then to me, it's Letterman. And so he will never be matched.
Right.
But I haven't given up living life, though.
I still enjoy food.
And I just did Conan. And I hadn't done Conan in a long time, and I loved it. I had a great time. So I think there will be outlets for me to do comedy is what I'm hoping.
Oh, of course, yes. There was a unique voice that Letterman had that I don't think anyone will ever recapture.
Yeah, he to me was the prime example among the other people like him. Richard Lewis did this, but on a night-to-night basis, Dave was the person who was no phony. He wasn't like Jimmy Fallon, everything's great. He was like making fun of himself, making fun of TV, making fun of corporations, making fun of everything. He was truly subversive without being overtly, hey, I'm trying to start a revolution. So I love to have that voice on a daily basis. And but it is true that everything has changed in terms of when people watch stuff and all that kind of stuff. It's never going to be like it was where everyone stayed up and watched one talk show, you know?
Right.
And so maybe he's the last person who people did, you know, forget about the numbers. The numbers to me are like, I don't care. Leno still had solid ratings, you know? They're going to talk about how Leno was unwatchable and Letterman was the man.
Well, yeah, Leno didn't, I mean, again, as a late night person, I could get into this for days, but the next day people weren't, you know, standing around the water cooler talking about an interesting thing Leno said, or a bit that Leno had.
And 20 years from now, people will have to Google water cooler. Yeah, no, he was a great, those of us remember from the 80s, he was an amazing stand-up, hilarious stand-up. But he got into this thing, it's a classic Greek or Roman or Italian tragedy. He got into this thing where he felt like he had to be a talk show host. He had to be this. It was all, it's this classic outside-in thinking. I want to be this, so I should be this. But he had no business even being a talk show host. He doesn't like sports. He doesn't like music. He wasn't in the moment. You know, he just wanted to make people happy. It was a classic decision that he made, that popularity was what he wanted. And
right.
And ultimately, who cares about popularity? I mean, I would like it money-wise.
Of course.
Exactly.
One other thing I wanted to talk to you about is a couple of your the TV shows that you recur on, both which I enjoy quite a bit. Marin, you've been on Marin a bunch, and you do a voice on Bob's Burgers, which I think is one of the best shows on television. It's maybe flies under the radar a little bit, but it's such a funny but yet warm show.
Yeah, the Marin, I think it's the fourth year, so I did like four episodes. I count everything, four episodes, and I love doing it. And I've always loved Mark, and I've known him for so long now. And the thing I love about that show is that I like this type of, you know, I loved Seinfeld, and I like shows where, like, when you look back at Seinfeld, there's so much absurd stuff happening, but it's never really, it's not like they're living on a different planet. It's all realistic. I like situation based comedy. So that's what I like about Mark's show, is that it's not exactly him, but it really is him in a heightened way. Yeah. And the thing has been, to me, like acting, you'll never win the game of saying to yourself, unless you're like Robert De Niro or, you know, like, that's all I can think of right now. Ryan Gosling or Meryl Streep, whatever, you know, whoever your favorite person is. You're never going to win the game of, I wonder if I'm a good, you know, am I acting okay? Because it's really an uncomfortable thing to do, to think about it and to look at yourself. But I've been very happy that as the more I've gotten a chance to do it, the more relaxed, like I'm trying to be like a low key guy, but relaxed in terms of I'm not even really thinking that much. And I think that's so, like, there is that feeling of, well, I'm Mark's friend, and now the cameras are rolling, and whatever the words are, it's that relationship. So that's been really, really amazingly fun. And then Bob's Burgers really goes all the way back to Dr. Katz. So Florian Bouchard, who created Bob's Burgers, he was a producer on Dr. Katz, and then on Home Movies.
Yeah.
And then there's a lot of people who were on. So, I mean, to me, John, there's nobody funnier in the world than, he's the funniest man, is John Benjamin. And so everybody in that show, Dan Mintz, Eugene Mervin, Christian Schaal, there's such great, John Roberts, who does the mother, is so funny. So it really is pure joy. And the other thing is, I think they just got picked up for like 40 more episodes. So those of you who wish that Andy Kindler, those of you who wish that I ended up old and penniless, you lose.
There will be lots more Mort.
No, lots of residuals. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about? A little do re mi. How could anybody not know what I'm talking about? A little simoleon, some shekels, some ice, some cabbage, stacks of dead presidents, toonies, as you say.
Nice throwing the Canadian reference in there. That's
Yeah, I like to do that. It's like, you know, I like to say just kilometers out of nowhere, just so the Canadians...
Not when referring to distances, just throw in the word.
Yeah, it's like it feels like it's unseasonably kilometerish this evening. I do love when you take when Google says go 300 feet and make a right. I have no idea unless it's the football field is the only unit of measurement I understand. Everything should be in football field. See, I'm working on material in this interview. It's all happening, people.
You've got some sports stuff still.
Oh, yeah, I still have some sports cred. I'm in your grill. I'm all up in your stuff.
You do know, though, that our football fields up in Canada are longer.
Yeah, 110, is that it?
Yeah, 110 yards, and then the end zones are twice as deep, too, so...
And I just want everybody to kind of know that we mock you down here for that.
As you should.
We find out what the Canadian football players make, and we laugh amongst ourselves about it. And then hope that a Canadian football player does not pummel me.
Right.
That's my whole life goal.
Canadian football players are more, they're of the people. They get paid what normal people get paid. So we... Nice.
Normal people need to get, I don't know what normal for you is, but I'd like to make $1 million a year.
That would be nice if that was normal.
Hey, it's all about the money. Follow the money, I say, and get some, follow the money and bring it back to me.
So you can have your lettuce, your cheddar, your, yeah.
Yes, I need a little cheddar. Did I say simoleons?
You did. That was the one that went over my head.
I don't even know what it means. Shekels is Israeli.
Yeah, that one I got. The final totally random thing is right before I was going to interview you, I was talking to a comedian friend of mine who's himself also in the Winnipeg Comedy Festival this year. And I said, quick, give me one question to ask Andy Kindler that you don't think I would have come up with. And he knew he was under pressure. And his question was, would you ever change your name to Candley Kindler?
I have not thought about it. This is the first time hearing this. Well, I think I would change my name to is it Candy Kindler?
Candy Kindler, yes.
Yeah. It sounds good. It sounds like it's very sexual, which I love. No, it's not sexual. It does sound, why would I take it as sexual? I need to go to my non-existent psychotherapist now. Okay. I have thought about changing my name to Andy Kindler because... 50% of the time when I'm introduced, because it's Andy Kindler, most people, including me or anybody, will say Andy because of the way the name is set up, Andy Kindler. So I think I should just surrender to it. And that's why I thought you asked Candley Kindler. And I kind of like that.
Well, I may have accidentally said Candley because, again, of the Kindler. It may have come out that way. I'll have to listen to the recording.
Yeah, but accidentally, like a fox, we stumbled into a eureka moment, a aha moment. We thought Candy Kindler was my future, but Candley Kindler is my new stage name, and I will be making up cards tonight.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing Candley Kindler up here in Winnipeg in a few weeks.
I'm looking forward to seeing you when I get up there. Please bring me to a coffee shop.
ShowbizMonkeys.com.